Hi friends, I'm Ajit, third year medical student from Government Thoothukudi Medical College. Today, we are going to discuss a topic which does not end only with biochemistry, but also follow up in pathology, pediatrics, orthopedics, and so on. So that topic will be collagen. Before entering into the topic proper, we will have a look on our case scenario. Our case scenario tells a 24-year-old woman presented with low back pain after water tubing. Her medical history included a Colles fracture at age 8 and several digital fractures in childhood. She denied smoking or consuming alcohol. She also added that her diet was absolutely normal and her menstrual history was also normal. She added that her father, who had been diagnosed with osteoporosis, had more than a dozen fractures, including hip fracture at age 54. Okay, on examination, the patient was 167 centimeter tall and weighed 52 kg. She had blue-gray sclera and slight poor dentition. What could be your probable diagnosis? So, before arriving into the diagnosis or thinking about diagnosis, we shall first discuss the topic and then again we will come to the case discussion. Okay, in this presentation, I will be covering the introduction part and what is collagen and what are their types and distribution and chemical structure of the collagen and how the collagen is synthesized and what is the applied biochemistry here, and finally we will arrive at our case discussion. Okay, first introduction. Fibrous proteins. What are fibrous proteins? These are some of the structural proteins present in the connective tissue of our body. It includes collagen, elastin, fibrillin, keratin, and laminin. Today, we will be learning more on the collagen and fibrillin. So, let us move into the topic proper. Collagen. So, what is collagen? Collagen is a major structural protein in extracellular matrix. It is the most abundant protein in the body. It's highly present in skin, followed by the cornea. Okay. Remember guys, its high concentration is present in the skin. High concentration is present in the skin followed by cornea. Okay. And about, there are 28 types of the collagens were found. But don't worry guys, we are not going to stress on the 28 types. We will be restricted to some types only. Okay. We will see this in detail later. Next, types of collagen. As I have said, we have about 28 types of the collagen in our body so far found. Among them, we will be stressing more on the type 1, type 2, type 3, type 4, then type 7. These are the most important applied biochemistry related collagen in our body. Let us see what is collagen type 1. This collagen type 1, they are the most abundant subtype of the collagen. They are mainly, it is present in non-cartilaginous. See the term non-cartilaginous, including bone, tendon, skin, cornea. If you take type 2, it is mainly present in cartilage and also vitreous humor. If you take type 3 collagen, it is mainly present in extensible connective tissues like skin, lung, then also very importantly, vascular system like blood vessels. Okay, then type 4. Type 4, it is mainly present in basement membranes. Basement membranes, you should think of the basement membrane which is present in our kidney and the basement membrane which is present in our eye and also basement membrane which is present in our internal ear. Okay. Then the next most important is collagen type 7. This collagen type 7, it is present in the dermal epidermal junction. Okay. These are the five most important collagens we have to fix in our mind. Okay. Rest types, we don't need to focus more. Just knew that there are 28 types, and among them, the type 1, type 2, type 3, type 4, and type 7 are most important. Next, we are going to deal about the structure. Okay, the collagen is actually a triple helix protein. Okay, remember, it is not a alpha helix. It is just a triple helix protein. Okay. What does the word triple means? It has three polyproline alpha chains. Remember guys, it is a alpha chains, not alpha helix. Okay, just three polyproline alpha chains. Here you can see this is one alpha chain, this is one alpha chain, and this is another alpha chain. So three polyproline alpha chains, and each chain they contains 1000 amino acids. Okay, this 1000 amino acids has a format nothing but glycine XY repeats. Okay, this alpha chain will have this sequence of amino acid nothing but glycine X and Y repeats. This X and Y, either it can be both hydroxyproline, or it can be both hydroxylysine, or it can be hydroxyproline and hydroxylysine. It depends upon the type of the collagen. Okay, and a very important point is every third amino acid is in the collagen is glycine. So in number they will say about 33% of amino acids present in the collagen is glycine. Okay, this is very important guys. Next, these collagens are actually resistant to unwinding. We cannot easily unwind the collagens because these two things are very important and highly confusing thing. Focus more individual alpha chains. Okay, individual alpha chains. I said there are three alpha chains in the collagen molecule, so these individual alpha chains are left handed. It is very very important. So individual chains are left handed. It is favored by an important amino acid known as proline. Okay, because this proline chemical, this amino acid has a ring form. Okay, this side chain ring, they facilitates the helix formation of the each alpha chain. Okay guys, remember individual alpha chains are left handed because there is a amino acid known as proline. This proline facilitates the helix formation of the each alpha chain. Okay, whereas if you take as a bunch, that is that a bunch of three alpha chains, they are right handed. Okay, this super helix is right handed because of the amino acid known as glycine. Okay, this glycine facilitates the right handed helix formation. Okay, because it is the simplest amino acid. Okay, it is the very simple amino acid. It can be accommodated in a less space, so only this glycine, they favors the right handed helix formation. So this is about the helix. So don't forget guys, individual alpha chains are always left handed and the super helix is right handed. Individual alpha chains are left handed due to proline and the super helix is right handed due to glycine. Next, we are going to see an important and unique arrangement which is present in the collagen. It is nothing but quarter staggered arrangement. Okay, it is the lateral association of the triplet helical units. Like if you take this is the first row of collagen molecule. Okay, see the next collagen molecule, in the second row the first collagen molecule, they starts after displacing 1/4 of the distance, about 1/4 of the distance away only. In next row the collagen molecule will be starting. So like this, in this manner it will be present. For example, if it is the first row, the next row will be from 1/4 away from the previous row. So such type of arrangement is known as quartet staggered arrangement. Okay, because this quartet staggered arrangement is essential for the tensile strength of the collagen molecule. So it is very important guys. Next, this is very important again. Not all the collagen fibers are fibrils. Some are modified to perform some other functions also. Like if you take the collagen type, collagen like a type 4, 8 and 10. Okay, basically they are not like a fibrils. They form a meshwork or network like appearance, so they becomes the integral part of the basement membranes. Okay, so they are called as collagen which forms network like functions. And also we are having some other collagens, they performing anchoring like functions, so they are called as anchoring fibrils. Okay, so the best example will be type 7. I have said that type 7 collagen, it is present in the dermoepidermal junction. Yes, this type 7 collagen, they anchors the basal lamina of the epidermis to the collagen fibrils which is present in the dermis, so that it keeps the dermis and epidermis close. And some other collagen, it is also present as a transmembrane proteins, okay, like 13 and 17, okay, like this. Many other functions also it is there. So fibril forming collagens are mainly type 1, type 2, type 3, type 5, type 6 and so on. Okay, these are the some various function collagen fibers. Now we are going to see about the collagen synthesis. Okay, the events for the collagen synthesis is basically split into two events. One is intracellular events and another one is extracellular events. Okay, in intracellular events there will be four events. First one will be cleavage of the signal peptide, then hydroxylation of the proline residues and some lysine residues, and there will be glycosylation of the some hydroxylysyl residues. Okay, then the formation of disulfide bonds and their formation of triple helix. This is about the intracellular events. I will explain in detail using the diagram. Then if you take extracellular, again it has also four steps. One will be cleavage of the amino and the carboxy terminal propeptides, and next will be assembly of the fibers in quarter straggle arrangement we have seen. Then there will be oxidative deamination of that lysyl and hydroxylysyl residues, which converts them to aldehydes, so that this aldehyde they condense and they form intra and interchain crosslinks. This crosslinks is very, very essential for the tensile strength of the collagen. So I will explain detailly in the picture. First, it is a fibroblast. Fibroblasts are the ones which they produces the collagen molecules. Okay, in fibroblast there will be a nucleus. That nucleus, after the transcription and translation, they produces collagen mRNA. Okay, this collagen mRNA they goes to the rough endoplasmic ribosomes. Rough endoplasmic reticulums where there is a presence of ribosomes to undergo translation. Okay, after the translation, okay, there is a formation of a precursor molecule known as pre-pro-collagen. Okay, this pre-pro-collagen is initially formed with a signal sequence. Okay, so the first process that takes place in the intracellular event will be that cleavage of the that signal peptides. For example, if you take it is a pre-peptide collagen, then there will be additional signal peptides like this. So there will be cleavage of this signal peptides. This will be the first one. Next, second, what will happen is after that, this pre-pro collagen will become pro collagen. That is, the pro alpha chains will be synthesized, which has glycine XY repeats. Okay, now this precursor molecule they undergoes an important step known as hydroxylation. This hydroxylation it takes place particularly in the proline and lysine residues. Okay, for this reaction to happen, an enzyme which is required is hydroxylases. Okay, which is proline hydroxylases or lysyl hydroxylases. For this enzyme to function, we need an important cofactor known as vitamin C. Vitamin C is very, very important for the activity of the hydroxylase enzyme, which is important for the hydroxylation reaction. Okay, once the hydroxylation reaction is completed, again there is another important process known as glycosylation. Okay, glycosylation is nothing but addition of carbohydrate molecule. Either glucose or galactose will be added to the mainly this hydroxylation molecules. Okay, to the hydroxylation molecules, so that it forms a procollagen molecule. So these are the three important steps, and the fourth important step will be triple helix formation. For this triple helix formation to occur, there should be a formation of disulfide bonds. Okay, these disulfide bonds, they unite all the three alpha chains together and they form the triple helix. Okay, once this triple helix is formed, it is now called as procollagen. Okay, this procollagen, which is present in the rough endoplasmic reticulum, now it's get packed into the vesicles. Like it gets packed into the vesicles after reaching Golgi apparatus. Okay, once they are stored into the secretory granules or secretory vesicles after the exocytosis, this procollagen is released into the extracellular matrix. Okay, now the intracellular events are over, and now the procollagen molecule has to undergo extracellular modifications. Okay, the extracellular modifications will be initially, if it is a procollagen, okay, there will be a carboxy terminal and also there will be amino terminals. So first there will be cleavage of these amino and carboxy terminals. So this will be the first step in the extracellular events. So after this, tropocollagen is formed. Okay, once this tropocollagen is formed, it gets assembly in a quarter staggered arrangement. We have seen that quarter staggered arrangement like this. Okay, once there is a formation of quarter staggered arrangement, there will be the next step known as formation of the crosslinks. It is very, very important, formation of the crosslinks. Okay, for the crosslinks to appear, there should be an important process known as oxidative deamination. Okay, that lysyl and hydroxylysyl residues, they should undergo oxidative deamination to form aldehydes. These aldehydes, they form crosslinks. Okay, for this reaction to happen, an important enzyme known as lysyl oxidase is very, very important. And for this enzyme to be active, an important cofactor known as copper is important. Okay, I will repeat again. Once the procollagen, which is packed in the secretory vesicles, undergoes exocytosis and released into the extracellular matrix, the first step will be cleavage of the carboxy and amino terminals, so that the procollagen will be converted into this tropocollagen. Once this finished, this tropocollagen molecules, they are arranged in quarter staggered arrangement. Okay, once they are arranged or once they are assembled, okay, then happens this oxidative deamination, particularly that lysyl and hydroxylysyl residues. Okay, once they are oxidative deaminated, they forms into aldehyde. This aldehyde forms the crosslinks. Okay, for this reaction to happen, an important enzyme known as lysyl oxidase is very important, and for this lysyl oxidase to be inactive, copper is very important cofactor. Okay, so by this manner, the collagen is synthesized in our body. Okay, next we are going to see about some of the collagen associated diseases. First will be osteogenesis imperfecta. Okay, the name itself tells, osteo means bone, genesis means formation, and imperfecta means imperfect. So there is imperfect bone formation. Okay, so it is a autosomal dominant collagen disorder. Okay, so what is the problem is, there is a gene known as COL1A1 and COL1A2 genes. Okay, it is easy guys, COL means collagen, 1 means type 1, and A means alpha, and 1 means alpha 1 chain. And same here also, collagen type 1 alpha 2. Okay, what is the defective means, there will be a decreased or defective formation of the type 1 collagen fibers. Okay, so this COL1A1 and COL1A2 genes are essential for the formation of the type 1 collagen fibers. Okay, now there is defective formation of the type 1 collagen fibers, so there will be a manifestation in here. So before going into the manifestation, we should know the normal locations of the type 1 collagen fibers. We have seen that type 1 collagen fibers is abundantly present in bone. Okay, in bones, this type 1 collagen fibers, they maintains the bone tensile strength. Okay, but patients with this osteogenesis imperfecta, they will have decreased or defective type 1 collagen fibers. So this bone tensile strength will be not proper. So there will be multiple long bones fractures and there will be bone deformity. Okay, if you see the x-ray, can you find a bony deformity here? So there is a bend in the femur. It indicates a bone deformity. And if you see these rounded places, you can see the fractures. So these are the some fractures and this is the bone deformity. Okay, then next, it is also present in eye. Okay, in eye, it is abundantly present in cornea and sclera. Okay, we have to know, guys, I have said after to the skin, next to skin, in cornea, there is much number of collagen, I have said. Yes, normally what happens, this sclera and cornea, they will have more collagen fibers. So they will be more thickening. Okay, so that we cannot see the structures behind the sclera and cornea. The structure which is seen behind is nothing but choroidal veins. So in a normal person, due to abundant collagen fibers in the cornea and sclera, we cannot see the choroidal veins. But in this patient, due to the decreased and defective formation of collagen fibers, the sclera becomes so thin. Okay, then the sclera, they behave like a translucent material, so that the behind choroidal veins blue color will be imparted. So we can expect a blue color sclera in a patient. Here in this picture, can you appreciate the blue color here? This. So this is the bluish sclera. Then it is also important for the teeth. Okay, in teeth there is an important protein known as dentine. Okay, for dentine formation we need a collagen fibers. Again, it is decreased in this case, so we can have a dental imperfections. Okay, and we have said no. It is a type 1 collagen fiber is very very important for bones. Bones like ear ossicles, okay, they are very important for the hearing mechanism. Once it is gets affected, there will be hearing loss. Okay, then as usual, it is present abundantly in skin. In skin, this makes the skin in normal texture. If it is lost, the blood vessels will be fragile and it can lead to petechial hemorrhages. So in short, osteogenesis imperfecta, it is autosomal dominant collagen disorder. Mutation in COL1A1 and COL1A2 genes, so there will be defective formation of the collagen, type 1 collagen fibers. Very important, type 1 collagen fibers. Remember the mnemonic bites. So B for bone. So bone tensile strength will be lost. So there will be multiple long bone fractures and also bone deformity. Then I for eye, remember cornea and sclera, they will have blue sclera. And for teeth, remember dental imperfections. And for E, ear ossicles has a bone. So it can lead to hearing loss. And lastly, skin. So in decreased collagen in skin leads to petechial hemorrhages. So this is about the osteogenesis imperfecta. So next we are going to see about Alport syndrome. Okay, Alport syndrome is also known as hereditary nephritis. Okay, it can be both X-linked and autosomal inheritance in manner. Okay, the point we have to know is this Alport syndrome. In Alport syndrome, there will be defective type 4 collagen. Okay, we have seen this type 4 collagen fibers. They are very very important for the basement membrane. Okay, I have said this type 4 collagen fiber is not a normal fibril, rather it acts as a basement membrane. Okay, so they become the integral part of the basement membrane. So in this patient, there will be defective basement membrane. I have said basement membrane is also present in kidney and also present in sensorine ear and also in eye. Okay, if the basement membrane in kidney is defective, it leads to an important clinical finding known as hematuria. Okay, so the blood starts excreted through the urine. So that is known as hematuria. And if the basement membrane in the ear is getting affected, it may lead to sensorineural hearing loss. Okay, again, this type 4 collagen fiber, it is also present in the basement membrane of the eye. Okay, so if it is getting affected, it may lead to lenticonus or ectopia lentis. So you can see the lens is shifted. Okay, so this is about the Alport syndrome. Don't forget, Alport syndrome, type 4 collagen is affected, so defective basement membrane. So hematuria, sensorineural hearing loss, and lenticonus. This is the triad about the Alport syndrome. Next, we will be dealing about epidermolysis bullosa. Okay. While we are seeing the types and distribution of the collagen, I have mentioned there is a collagen known as type 7. So I said it acts like a anchoring fibrils. Okay. They act as anchoring fibrils. If you see in this picture, this is a epidermis and epidermal cells are there. This is the basement membrane and below the basement membrane, can you appreciate this yellow color fibers? These yellow color fibers are nothing but the collagen 7, and below that orange one fibers are nothing but the normal collagen fibers which is present in the dermis. Okay, what this type 7 does is, this type 7 collagen fibers, one end it is attached to the basement membrane of the epidermis and another end it is getting attached to the collagen fibers which is present in the dermis, so that it keeps the epidermis and dermis closer. Okay, what happens if there is any defect to the type 7 collagen? So there will be separation of the dermis and the epidermis, so there is a formation of blisters in the skins. So this is the blister formation. Okay, so there is defective type 7 collagen synthesis, so there is a reduced anchoring fibrils, so there will be separation of epidermis from the dermis. Okay, so this is about the epidermolysis bullosa. Okay guys, one minute. Next we are going to see about Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. These are actually a group of syndromes. There are variety of Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, but most commonly these features will be seen in all mostly. What are they? There will be hyper extensibility of the skin. Okay, here can you appreciate that there is a hyper extension? Normally we cannot have this much extension in our body. In their body they can have a hyper extensibility of the skin, and there will be abnormal tissue fragility, and there will be hyper mobile joints. Okay, can you appreciate? We cannot do like this normally, but in these patients can do because their joints are hypermobile. Okay, there are varieties of the Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. It is mainly based on the what type of collagen is affected. Okay, let us see the classification of Ehlers-Danlos syndrome in short. There's a famous classification known as Willi-Franz classification. This Willi-Franz classification classifies the Ehlers-Danlos syndrome as a 6 important types. Okay, but we are more concerned about these first 3 segments only. Okay, the first one will be hypermobility Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. This hypermobility Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, the main collagen defective is type 3 collagen fiber. We have seen this type 3 collagen fiber is present in vascular structures and skin. Okay, so there will be joint hypermobility, then skin abnormalities and osteoarthritis. So this is about the hypermobility Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. Next one will be classical. Okay, so classical Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, it is comparatively severe than the hypermobility. Okay, here the affected collagen is type 1 and type 5. Okay, so along with this, it will be similar to the hypermobility type, but involvement of the type 1 fibers and type 5 collagen, they make skin abnormalities more severe. So they will have more skin abnormalities, like there will be more hyper extensibility of the skin. So this is about the classical Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. And the third one important is vascular subtype. It is the most serious and dangerous Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. Its prognosis is very poor because the affected collagen is type 3. Okay, we have seen that type 3 collagen is very important for hyper extensible tissues, like it is essential for skin, and it is also important for blood vessels. Okay, so what happens is, in these patients there will be fragile blood vessels. Okay, so and there will be also thin and translucent skin, so it will become easily bruising. Okay, so these patients they may have aneurysms in their blood vessels, like bulging of the blood vessels which may rupture. Okay, so only it is told that vascular subtype of the Ehlers-Danlos syndrome is most serious subtype. Okay, and also subtype like kyphoscoliosis associated Ehlers-Danlos syndrome is there, then anthrocalcinosis associated Ehlers-Danlos syndrome there, but up to biochemistry knowledge we can fix to the hypermobility classical and vascular subtype. So this is about the Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. Don't forget that Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, they mainly have hyper extensibility of the skin, then abnormal tissue fragility and hypermobile joints. Okay, do scurvy and Menkes disease affect collagen synthesis? Yes, obviously it affects. Let us see how it affects the collagen synthesis and how does they manifest. What is scurvy? Scurvy is basically a severe vitamin C deficiency status. Okay, it is known as scurvy. Okay. So during collagen synthesis, I have said an important enzyme. Okay. That is nothing but hydroxylases. Okay. Which involves in the hydroxylation reaction. Okay. So for this reaction to happen, and this enzyme is very, very important. And for this enzyme, vitamin C is very, very, very important. So if there is severe vitamin C deficiency, there will be a defective hydroxylases enzyme function, and there will be abnormal hydroxylation. Okay. So the resulting will be abnormal collagen. Okay. So only in scurvy, we have manifestations like bleeding comes, hemorrhages, and poor wound healing capacity. So all are due to this abnormal collagen. Okay. Whereas if you take Menkes disease, what is this Menkes disease? It is a genetic disorder in which there is a dietary deficiency of the copper. Okay. So during collagen synthesis, we have seen this copper is very, very important for an enzyme known as lysyl oxidases. Okay, where we have seen that enzyme, this lysyl oxidases, they involve in oxidative deamination. Okay, this step is very, very important for the covalent crosslinks formation. Okay, so there will be defective covalent cross formation, so there will be defective collagen, and mostly they present with the vascular abnormalities. Okay, so in this manner, in scurvy and Menkes disease, the collagen fiber formation is affected, and they have that manifestations. Next, so far we have seen about the collagen, and the next one, small another clinically important to the like collagen is fibrillin. Okay, this fibrillin is it is also a structural protein and one of the most important structural component of the connective tissues, and they are produced by again fibroblast. They are the structural component of microfibrils. Okay, so basically there are two types of fibrillin: fibrillin 1 and fibrillin 2. It is very, very important. It's fibrillin 1 and fibrillin 2, but the most important is fibrillin 1. Okay, because it is a major type, and it is very, very important, guys. It is present in zonular fibers of the lens. Okay, at least remember this fibrillin 1 is very important for lens, and it is also important in periosteum. Okay, periosteum, it is a layer in your bone. Okay, then it is also associated with the elastin fibers, which is present in the aorta. Okay, so this fibrillin 1 has to do something with the lens, periosteum, and aorta. So don't forget this, guys. Fibrillin, it is a glycoprotein secreted by the fibroblast, which is a structural component of the microfibrils. Among the two types, fibrillin 1 is the most important type, and it is present in lens, periosteum, and elastic fibers in the aorta. Okay, now what is Marfan syndrome? Okay, Marfan syndrome is nothing but it is a genetic syndrome in which there will be a mutations in a gene which encodes for the protein known as fibrillin 1. Okay, this gene is present in the chromosome 15. Okay, when it gets mutated, there will be abnormalities in the structures of the fibrillin 1. We have seen this fibrillin 1 is essential for lens, and it is essential for arteries like aorta, along with the elastin fibers, and it's also present in periosteum. Periosteum. Okay, so these three places are more affected. It is mainly due to elevated levels of the TGF beta. Okay, which you guys will be studying in pathology. Okay, just remember there will be elevated levels of the TGF beta. Okay, so there will be abnormality in the suspensory ligament of the eye. Okay, so there will be ectopia lentis. Okay, so ectopia lentis is also known as the lenticonus. It is due to abnormal suspensory ligament of the eye, and we can also see arachnodactyly. It is due to the abnormality in the periosteum. Okay, and there will be dilatation of the ascending aorta. Okay, it is due to we have seen it is also present along with the elastin fibers. So there will be dilatation of the ascending aorta, and it may form an aneurysm, and later it may also rupture. So this is about the pathogenesis of the Marfan syndrome. Now we can see some important clinical aspects. Okay, guys. Now we are seeing the clinical presentation of the Marfan syndrome. Okay, from head to toe, if you see First in eye we can have lens dislocation. Okay, then we can have eye arched neck. In neck, okay. Then in chest there can be a chest wall abnormalities, like they can have a pectus carinatum or pectus excavatum. Anything can be happen, and they will have disproportionately long arms. Okay, and they will have long fingers. So that is arachnodactyly, and they also have disproportionately long legs. So total all over they are very tall, and they are if you see the nourishment status, they will be very thin. Okay, then they will have flexible joints, and again if you see any spinal abnormalities, there can be a scoliosis also. Okay, then if you take a cardiovascular system, they can have complications like initially they can have aortic dilatation, which may leads to aortic aneurysm, which if they progresses, they may causes aortic dissection. Okay, or they may also causes mitral valve prolapse. Okay, these are some important clinical features pertaining to the Marfan syndrome. So now we are going to our clinical discussion. Yes, we have came to our final part of our session. Again, I am reading once again this question. 24-year-old woman presents with low back pain. Her medical history includes Colles fracture at the age of 8 and several digital fractures in childhood. So it indicates she is having a past history of multiple fractures. Okay, history of multiple fractures. Okay, then she denies smoking or consuming alcohol. That is fine. Then she also added that her diet was absolutely normal. Okay, diet, it also excludes the vitamin D deficiency induced fractures. Okay, so we can exclude vitamin D deficiency or calcium deficiency from the options. Okay, then her menstrual history was also normal. Okay, then she tells that her father, who had been diagnosed with osteoporosis, he also had a dozen of fractures, including hip fractures at age 54. Okay, it indicates that there is a familial history of fractures. So this disorder, they must run in families. So further on examination, the patient was 167 centimeters tall and 52 kg weight. Okay, then further examination tells she had blue gray color sclera. This is very, very important, guys. We have studied somewhere in some condition there will be blue color sclera, so that is blue gray sclera, and also poor dentition. Okay, so what could be your probable diagnosis? Now again, fetch back the important clinical points, that history of multiple fractures and the familial history of fractures, and there is blue color sclera and also poor dentition. So all those point they put forward for a single and easy diagnosis, which is nothing but osteogenesis imperfecta. Okay, so our probable diagnosis should be osteogenesis imperfecta. So this is about this case discussion. Friends, I hope I have given some amount of knowledge regarding the collagen, and thank you for attending the session, guys. Thank you so much.